examples of that.
In here.
We're in Aberdeen, South Dakota. Step into my studio.
For every different type of pen type, you have to have different bushings. And these are bushings for a gunmetal bolt action click pen, which I'm going to be making.
It started about in 2015. My older brother Mitch was in the Navy, and he was stationed out in Seattle. I think it was called Bremerton Substation. And he was turning pens. And so when I first started at Court Services, I wanted to have a pen made for everyone in my office. Well, then my boss at the time got interested in it. And I think he went up to Eureka and found an auction sale where they had like a bandsaw, a drill press, and a good turning lathe. And he started working on pens. So then we went to Tennessee, and there was a woodcraft store up there, and we got some pen blanks, and I made my first pen. It was actually a tiger colored orange and black acrylic pen. The most important thing is a sharp chisel. And then I just built it from there, you know, got my, you need a bandsaw and a drill press, of course. And then I started making stuff on my own. And it was just, if I get an order, then I'll make a pen for somebody. So I get the money from order it through a company in Pennsylvania. It's really not only a hobby for me, but it's a stress reliever. You know, when I make a pen, I zone out and I get making my pen, that's it. So that's how I got started, and that's, you know, where I am today with it. I made a piece of deer antler for the blank of the pen. And so I've got a whole tub of deer antlers, and then I got some other ones. So you have to cut it to about the length you need for the pen. And so for a bolt action pen that you saw, it's about just shy of 2 inches. So I cut it a little longer, and I put it up in that drill press, and then I drill the hole with a drill bit. I drill a hole through it. And every pen kit, every different pen type has basically a different size drill bit, right? So I drill through it, and I glue that brass tube that comes in the kit in there. You have to leave it sit for like 20 minutes. I've got some spray accelerator, that white can up there, and that works really well. And then I have two bits that I can drill into there to size it down to the length. And then I have a box there with the different bushings. And so I know how far down to take it. So then I mount it on the lathe, and then I turn it down to size. I have sandpaper and polish. And then a press there that you can press them together. I usually have pretty good luck with wood and the antler. The most technical is the acrylic, because sometimes that's brittle and it chips. And so I have to order two, because I have to expect that probably it's gonna chip. I cannot use like sheds that lay out in the elements, because they get bleached out. But like the inside is marrowy, but the outside is more of the bone part, or the harder, clearer white. So about 2 inches, 3 inches of straight, thick antler. And then I always thought, what am I gonna do with the extras? Like this piece, this is what I'd use to make a deer antler coat rack or a hat rack. So you can mount it right on the wood. I've made a few game calls. They have duck calls, rabbit calls, coyote calls, wine stoppers, bottle stoppers. And it takes time, you know. You learn different tricks from people that already know. If it's something you're interested in, you know, talk to somebody and find out how to get involved in it. I get some breakage, and, you know, it's not necessarily a disaster, but there's ways to fix it. If I'm turning something and it breaks, you can actually take that and grind it up, put a little glue on there, super glue, and take that fine grindings and put it on there and press it in there, and then sand it down, and sometimes you can't even tell that it broke. You know, I grew up camping and hunting and fishing, and I just enjoy that. And it's kind of a way to preserve that, I think.